This is the first short video for the week of April the 13th to April the 18th. And we're starting on chapter 13. This will be on the next test. But we must bravely go through this because we're stuck here at home, quarantining ourselves. We can't meet in person. So I thought I'd start off with a little humor on the importance of braveness, and then we'll go on to chapter 13. Here's a kind of a funny video. Here we go. I'm going to show you. I kind of like this humor.
The Tale of Sir Robin. So each of the knights went their separate ways. Sir Robin rode north through the dark forest of Ewing, accompanied by his favorite minstrels.
Bravely bold Sir Robin rode forth from Camelot. He was not afraid to die, oh brave Sir Robin. He was not at all afraid to be killed in nasty ways. Brave, 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 brave Sir Robin. He was not in the least bit scared to be mashed into a pulp, or to have his eyes gouged out and his elbows broken, to have his kneecap split and his body burned away, and his limbs all hacked and mangled, brave Sir Robin. His head smashed in and his heart cut out and his liver removed and his bowels unplugged and his nostrils raked and his bottom burnt off and his penis...
That's enough music for now, lads. Looks like there's dirty work afoot.
And not oh syndicalism is a way of preserving freedom.
Oh, Dennis, forget about freedom. Don't drop that mud.
Robin,
brave Sir Robin.
Shut up!
Nobody really. Just passing through.
What do you want?
To fight.
Shut
and...
up! Nothing really. Just to pass through. Good tonight.
I'm afraid not.
Ah, well, actually, I am a knight of the Round Table.
You're a knight of the Round Table?
I am.
In that case, I shall have to kill you.
Shall I? Oh, I don't think so.
What do I think?
I think kill it.
Oh, let's be nice to him.
Oh, shut up. And you.
Oh, quick, get the sword out. I want to cut his head off.
Oh, cut your own head off.
Yes, do us all a favour.
What?
Yapping on all the time.
You're lucky you're not next to him.
What do you mean?
You snore.
Oh, I don't. Anyway, you've got bad breath.
Well, it's only because you don't brush my teeth.
Oh, stop bitching and let's go and have tea.
All right. We'll kill him first and then have tea and biscuits.
Yes.
Oh, not biscuits. All right.
Not biscuits,
but let's kill him anyway.
Right.
He's buggered off.
So he has. He's scarpered.
Brave Sir Robin ran away.
No.
Bravely ran away.
I didn't.
When danger reared its ugly head, he bravely turned his tail.
No.
And yet brave Sir Robin turned about.
I didn't.
Gallantly he chickened out. Bravely taking
I never did.
Head, he beat a very brave retreat.
Oh, Lord.
Bravest of the brave.
I thought you could use some humor there. I don't know if you like that or not, but anyway. Chapter 13, Paleozoic Life History, Vertebrates and Plants. So, chapter 12, we talked about invertebrates, going all the way from the Cambrian to the Ordovician to the Silurian, the Devonian, Mississippian, Pennsylvanian, to the last period of the Paleozoic era, called the Permian. That's when the great mass extinction occurred, the greatest mass extinction in Earth history, 245 million years ago. We haven't talked about the vertebrates yet. Vertebrates belong to phylum Chordata. And the first vertebrates, please don't forget this, to appear on planet Earth appeared during the Cambrian period. And they are the fish. The fish are the first vertebrates to appear on planet Earth, as far as the fossil record, that's what the fossil record indicates. And they look kind of like this, very primitive fish. Like this, you can, if you take a good close look at this fish, it doesn't have any jaws, it doesn't have eyes yet, and it just has, this is its tail over here, and it has these little tentacles here, and it would suck in water and remove things to eat from the water. So very primitive type of fish. But they're the first vertebrates, organisms that have skeletons. Here you can see the embryo, the cells in the embryo for fish and for all vertebrates. This is how they arrange themselves. And they are very similar. In fact, they're almost exactly the same as echinoderms, phylum Echinodermata. So many scientists believe that the fish evolved from the echinoderms. You might recall from Fossils Lab, we looked at quite a few echinoderms, blastoids, class Blastoidea from the Paleozoic era, and then we had crinoids. Crinoids can be Paleozoic, Mesozoic, or Cenozoic. We had Echinoidea, sand dollars, and sea urchins. They can be found in the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic. And then we also had Asteroidea, which is starfish. And they can be found in the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, or Cenozoic. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the most important diagram in the beginning of this chapter, chapter 13. And it shows you, a lot of people, most of you understand now that the Phanerozoic eon consists of three eras. Paleozoic era goes from 542 million years ago to 245 million years ago. The Mesozoic era, which goes from 245 million years ago to 65 million years ago. And the Cenozoic era, the era we're now living in, goes from 65 million years ago to now. Most of you also know that these are periods. These are not eras. And the first period of the Paleozoic era is the Cambrian, followed by the Ordovician, then the Silurian, Devonian. Instead of using Carboniferous, which they use in the UK, we will say Mississippian, Pennsylvanian, Permian. Those are periods. The Mesozoic era has three periods: Triassic period, Jurassic, Cretaceous period. Cenozoic, the Brits use Paleogene, Neogene, but we're going to use Tertiary and Quaternary, but don't worry, I'll talk about that a couple weeks from now. As you can see here, the first fish appeared during the Cambrian period. There are six kinds of fish that you need to know for this next test. And I'm going to go over them with you one at a time. The first is the ostracoderms, O-S-T-R-A-C-O-D-E-R-M-S. These are the first fish to appear in the rock record, the ostracoderms. Second type of fish we're going to talk about is the acanthodians, A-C-A-N-T-H-O-D-I-A-N-S. You can see the spelling in your book. Third type of fish are called the placoderms, P-L-A-C-O-D-E-R-M-S. You probably never heard of these three kinds of fish. As you can see from the diagram, they all became extinct somewhere during the Paleozoic. So these three are all extinct types of fish: ostracoderms, acanthodians, and placoderms. These other three kinds of fish still exist today. You can see they still live today. And we're going to talk about them. First is the lobe fin fish, then the cartilaginous fish, things like skates and sharks are cartilaginous fish. They don't have bone, they have cartilage. And then the ray fin fish. The ray fin fish is every fish you've ever seen in your life, probably. And they're the most successful line of fish existing today. Trout, bass, perch, bluegill, flounder, tuna. Any fish that you've ever seen in your life has probably been a ray fin fish, unless you've seen a shark. So let's talk about these six kinds of fish. The first and earliest fish to appear in the rock record, in the geological record, are the astracoderms. They appeared during the Cambrian, and they died out at the end of the Devonian. You might recall there was a second great mass extinction occurred during the Devonian. Let's take a look at these astracoderms for a moment. Astracoderms. These show you, this diagram here shows you different types of astracoderms. These are fish that might look quite unusual to you because they died out a long time ago at the end of the Devonian. How are they different than today's fish? Well, first take a look and you tell me. Take a look at those fish. First thing that stands out in my mind's eye is that they have bony armor. They have bone on the outside of their body, especially around their head. Another thing that you might make note of is that instead of having fins, they have these little paddles so they can move forwards. Third thing about this fish is they don't have jaws. They can't chew food. They have to sift the sediment on the bottom of the seafloor and remove anything that's edible from that sediment. Look at their eyes. How are their eyes different than modern fish? Well, first of all, they're closely spaced, and they're on the top of the fish's head, not the side of the head. And that tells paleontologists a lot. It tells us that these fish, sort of like catfish today, they stay on the bottom of the ocean. Catfish stay on the bottom of lakes, but these stay on the bottom of the ocean, and they can see above with the eyes. Since the eyes are on the top of the head, they can see above. They can look for enemies coming from above, or they can also look for food sources coming up from above. Their eyes were very small and primitive, so they didn't have really great eyesight. How do we know they swam on the bottom of the ocean? They are nectonic because they did swim, but how do we know that they swam on the bottom of the ocean? Well, they had to. With all this bone on the outside of their body, they'd be too heavy to swim up higher up in the water column. These are the ostracoderms. Please don't forget these are the first fish to appear. And this is what they look like in case a picture of it shows up on the final exam. And know about their characteristics. No, they died out at the end of the Devonian. This is the first line of fish to die out. Astracoderms. They don't have jaws. You should also remember that. Second type of fish we need to know about are these. Acanthodians. Acanthodians. Let me show you a few pictures of what those look like. I'm going to spell it for you here, ladies and gentlemen. Acanthodians. These are acanthodians. This is the second line of fish to appear in the rock record. They are extinct. Acanthodians are extinct. And the thing, look at their spiny fins. That's something you don't see in modern fish. Often at times they would have two of these dorsal fins on top. A lot of them had two. Fish today only have one. And the pectoral fins, the fins on the bottom, they had numerous ones. Whereas modern fish usually only have one pair of pectoral fins. Their tail fins are not symmetrical. One is long, one end, the top end is longer and sticks out, and the other one is shorter. But the big thing about these acanthodians fish that you should remember, besides they're the second line of fish, type of fish to appear in the rock record, is that they do have bony armor around their head. There's bone around its head. Modern fish don't have bone on the outside of their body. But number one thing you want to remember about acanthodians is they're the first fish to have jaws. So these fish were able to chew their food. What's the advantage of chewing your food? It makes it easier to digest. Also, these fish have less bone on the outside of their body, only around their head. And so they could swim much easier. All fish are nectonic in lifestyle, but these fish could swim a lot easier, and they were more mobile than ostracoderms. Third line of fish you want to remember, again, these three lines of fish are extinct. They only exist during the Paleozoic era, are the placoderms. And I think you'll find these quite interesting. Let me show you what they look like. These are monstrously huge fish. Here's, let me show you a picture of what some of these look like. This is Dunkleosteus, and there's a spelling for you. This was enormous. This could be 30, 40 feet long, and it ate sharks. Look at its, how is it different than modern fish? Well, it's got bone around its head. It's got paddle-like arms instead of fins. It does have jaws. It could chew its own food. But this is not like acanthodians. It doesn't have all of those spiny fins on it. Plus, these are much larger. Look how monstrous these fish are, with enormous sharp teeth. If you see one of these on the test, what is it called again? It's called a placoderm. You can see that's all bone around its head here. Placoderms. They were the largest predators in the Paleozoic oceans. Now let's talk about the modern three types of fish: lobe fin fish, cartilaginous fish, and ray fin fish. These all have survived till today. First one I'll talk to you about is the lobe fin fish. You probably never seen a lobe fin fish unless you've been to Africa. Get some pictures so I can show you what these look like. Okay, lobe fin fish, we used to think they were extinct until the 1930s when we found some of them that are still alive. This is what they look like. Notice they have three sets of pectoral fins, two dorsal fins. These fish used up to the 1930s, we used to think they were extinct. And the lobe fin fish, very important to remember. Let's take a look. Here's your lobe fin fish here. Notice that they have arms and fingers. In fact, there are types of lobe fin fish that, since they have these primitive legs, meaning their ancestors must have walked on the land. Their ancestors will walk on the land, as we'll see. They are the ancestors of the amphibians, the next type of vertebrate to appear. So what's the first type of vertebrate to appear in the rock record? Lobe fin fish. I mean, all kinds of different fish. Ostracoderms, placoderms, acanthodians, lobe fin fish, bony fish, cartilaginous fish. The fish appeared first. Then the amphibians would appear next. Somewhere during the Silurian and the Devonian, the lobe fin fish would evolve into the amphibians. And how do we know that? I'm going to show you more evidence as we go on. They have almost identical skeletons, amphibians do to lobe-finned fish. They have the same foot structure and pelvis. Therefore, amphibians must have evolved from the lobe-finned fish. Don't forget that. Next type of fish we're going to take a look at, cartilaginous fish. Cartilaginous fish include sharks, rays, and skates. This is what a skate looks like. You might have heard of the crocodile hunter. Unfortunately, he got one of these spikes and he impaled on one of these things and died. That was such a horrible thing to happen. I remember when it happened. Sharks, rays, and skates. These don't have bones, and they don't have bones. They have cartilage inside. That's why we call them cartilaginous fish. These are very powerful predators, nectonic predators. Those are your cartilaginous fish. Ray fin fish are every fish you've ever seen in your life, probably, unless you've seen a shark or a skate. And ray fin fish, they have, you can see these little bones in the fins. In this tail fin, you can see they radiate outward like rays. See how they radiate outwards like this? The bones point outwards like this in rays. That's why I call them ray fin fish. They are every fish. They're the most common fish today. See how these bones all go out like rays? And they're the most successful fish today. So there, ladies and gentlemen, are the six types of fish you need to know about. You need to know what they look like, their outstanding characteristics, things that we can use to identify them, when they lived. You need to know about the fish. Here's the Linnaean classification scheme. Obviously, fish belong to phylum Chordata. And here's the classes of the fish here, in case you see those somewhere in the fossils lab. You go back here to the classes of the fish. If you're having problems with the fossils lab, I'll give you a big hint. Look in your lab manual. Almost everything is there. You can Google it and you can look online, but I tell you, everything's in that lab manual. Here's different kinds of fish. You should know acanthodians. Here is a placoderm. There's an astracoderm. Here's a ray fin fish. You should know what they look like. The Devonian period, interestingly enough, was the only period where all five types of fishes existed. How did we go from the astracoderms to the acanthodians? The astracoderms had no jaws. They looked like this fish over here. They had to suck in the water and remove food. These things here, these bones, are called gills. That's how the fish breathes. Most scientists believe that these two sets of bones in the front for the gills of the astracoderms evolved through genetic mutations to make jaws. So this is how we went from fish without jaws to fish with jaws. The acanthodians evolved from astracoderms. The first sets of gill slits evolved through genetic mutations to make jaws. And what's the first type of fish to have jaws? Acanthodians. Please don't forget that acanthodians and placoderms became extinct at the end of the Permian. That means at the end of the Paleozoic. And the astracoderms became extinct at the end of the Devonian. But all of those three extinct lines of fish, died out within the Paleozoic era. Again, cartilaginous fish. There's a big placoderm here, predator. Here's a smaller placoderm, and ray fin fish. Here's a cephalopod, phylum Mollusca, class Cephalopoda, nectonic. Probably a meal for many of these different types of fish. Here's a placoderm from China, bony head. This is not a shark because it has a skeleton. Here's your ray fin fish. They have bones, not cartilage. And here's your lobe fin fish. Which one evolved to become the amphibians? The lobe fin fish. In Africa, you find some lobe fin fish with strong legs, and they live in ponds. And when ponds dry up, they can actually walk a couple hundred yards to another pond. They can hold their breath for a long time and survive in that way. These are lobe fin fish, and they're the ancestors of the amphibians. Here's the first amphibians. They evolved from lobe fin fish, the first vertebrates to invade the land. Big difference between an amphibian and a fish, besides the fact that they have strong legs, is amphibians are the first fish, the first vertebrates to have lungs. So they evolved to have lungs. They could breathe air without on the land instead of having to be in the water. Look at the skeleton of an ancient salamander, an amphibian called Labyrinthodon, and look at the lobe fin fish. Look how similar their skeletons are. The only difference is that the salamander has even stronger legs for walking on the land and slightly modified skeleton, but clearly they're so similar that we think that the amphibians evolved from the lobe fin fish. More evidence that the amphibians evolved from the lobe fin fish. Look at the foot bone structure of the amphibian versus the lobe fin fish. They have the same bones. Why would they have the same bones unless they were related to one another? Something that's really useful to identifying organisms is the shape of their teeth. They have the same exact, almost the exact same set type of teeth. Look at the shape of the teeth. These are clear indicators that the amphibians evolved from the lobe fin fish. Here's some of the early amphibians. Some characteristics you want to remember about amphibians. They're the first vertebrates to invade the land, the first vertebrates to breathe air through lungs. What types of amphibians do we have living today? We have salamanders, newts, frogs, toads. I'm sure you've seen salamanders growing up in your life. One thing about salamanders and toads and frogs and all amphibians is that their form of sexual reproduction is different. And we'll talk about that more in the next video. So I'm going to stop it right here, and I'm going to go eat lunch, and later on I'm going to make a second video.